This program brought to you by the Seekers' new album, Future Road.
Without a doubt, one of the great success stories in Australian music history are the Seekers. Would you believe, way back in 1964, this four-piece group left Australian shores to gain their fame and fortune. By 1965, they'd gained a number one hit both on the Australian charts and the UK charts. By 1967, they're an international household name. And would you believe, they returned here in 1967 at the Maya Music Bowl and played in front of 200,000 people. So let's, 30 years later, trace the legend of the Seekers from their past to Future Road.
Oh, nice one. Like it.
It's very peaceful and quiet here today at the Maya Music Bowl, as opposed to 30 years ago. 200,000 people, what was it like to perform in front of?
Oh, an amazing day, absolutely stunning day. I remember at the end of that day seeing how quiet it is now. We were in our dressing room downstairs having come off stage after our last number, and all we could hear outside was this roar and this thumping of, we want more, we want more. And we didn't know what to do. I don't know whether we were terrified or what, but it was unbelievable.
Yeah, because we had no idea when we planned our concert. We only planned a 20-minute set, and we had the orchestra playing, of course, too, Hector Crawford's orchestra. So we hadn't really rehearsed encores or anything. And the whole crowd took everybody by surprise. And to look out there, I mean, it was a bit different then, because the landscaping's different now, and you could see further out. So there was this huge sea of faces, and people up all around the edges hanging their feet over. It was just brilliant.
Well, I mean, tell us about that morning. I mean, like, I believe, you know, you got a call from Channel 7 saying you better come in and have a look at this, or what's happening at the Maya Music Bowl.
Well, the thing that that happened was that we had been planning to videotape the, to film the segment anyway, but Norm Spencer, who was directing at that stage, he rang through and said, look, they're arriving a lot earlier than we thought. You know, in fact, people started coming at about 7 o'clock in the morning. And when we arrived, we just had to battle our way through the crowds. You know, the police were having all sorts of problems with directing the traffic and directing the crowds, and it was just magnificent.
When you left, that was basically the first time Australia, and certainly Melbourne, had had a taste of swinging London, a la like the Beatles coming out here, the scenes outside the Southern Cross, the scenes at Festival Hall. Did the Seekers ever go through that? I mean, obviously you're saying that day you did. I mean,
yes. Well, we did. We had a taste of it every now and then, but you see, we didn't attract that kind of hysteria because we weren't from a sort of a teenage hysteria kind of act. You know, we were appealing to the complete family, three generations then as we are three generations now. So I think really that's the difference, but people were really wanting to touch us a lot. They'd all come to the airports to meet us and want to reach out and touch us and that sort of stuff. But it was kind of on a friendship.
Very, very much so.
It's always been like that, wanting to, because we want to hug each other kind of a thing, you know, different, not grabbing our hair and wanting a bit of our clothing and that sort of stuff.
So part of the family.
Well, talking about being part of the family, I mean, you became the ambassadors for Australia. Was that hard to live up to?
Well, no, it was easy.
I asked that only because we're known as the beers, or certainly back then, certainly to the Poms, as we'll say.
Well, we swilled the odd beer when we had to. I mean, we weren't, it was never a problem. But we were welcomed so warmly wherever we went. And when people acknowledged the fact that we were Australians, because sometimes people didn't know that we were actually from Australia, then we were able to, you know, through our music and the videos that were subsequently done, especially the Seekers Down Under, part of which was filmed right here, that went around the world as both a promotion for immigration to Australia as well as tourism, especially, and they're even using it for tourism purposes today.
Yeah.
And, you know, we just the groups seem to move at another level rather than just a pop group, which has always been the case, and we've always, you know, respected that.
Close the door, light the light. We're staying home tonight, far away from the bustle and the bright city lights. Let them all fade away. Just leave us alone, and we'll live in a world of our own. We'll build a world of our own that no one else can share. All our sorrows we'll leave far behind us there. And I know you will find there'll be peace of mind when we live in a world of our own.
For the first time in 30 years, a new album from Judith Durham and the Seekers, Future Road. Featuring the new single, Calling Me Home. Judith Durham, Bruce Woodley, Keith Potker and Athel Guy, together again. The unique sound of Judith Durham and the Seekers. Be touched by the magic again with the brilliant new album, Future Road. Out now.
Well, team, welcome to this wonderful little carriage here on Puffing Billy. Does it bring back memories?
Oh, wonderful. Here we are again. Someone said to us, welcome, and then they changed their welcome to saying, welcome back.
Right, yes.
Wonderful, wonderful to be here.
And all the children who were with us, of course, they'd all be grown up too now.
Absolutely.
They were off with St. Vincent de Paul's orphanage, actually. Yes.
Right.
Yeah, and we all had a wonderful time. We're all sitting up the front and singing away, Morningtown Rye.
All down for Morningtown, many miles away. Driver at the engine, fireman rings the bell, sandman swings the lantern to show that all is well. Rock and roll and ride out.
Of course, Morningtown Ride was a very big change in a sense that it got children involved in our music very much too.
Yeah, Lullaby broadened the base of our appeal incredibly. So, and you know, I mean, appropriately talking about it here today, because we'd probably like to think we did a lot of good for Puffing Billy as well.
Yeah.
Maybe help keep it alive.
Absolutely. And that was written by Malvina Reynolds, who'd written Little Boxes, and of course the legendary What Have They Done to the Rain, which we ended up recording too.
Well, way back then, unlike any other bands, where they waited to win, say, like a Battle of the Bands or Battle of the Sounds to get that free trip over to England, you took the stand like the Bee Gees did. I mean, like, they went over with no promises, no contracts, with just, Morris and Barry say, with a shilling in their pocket, arrived in London and basically was signed up by Robert Stigwood. And you more or less did the same. What inspired you to think, well, we'll go overseas, you know?
I mean, well, I was a bit travel mad in a way. I have to say, my office at J. Walter Thompson that Judith referred to before looked out over Princes Pier, and I could see the big ships come and go on a weekly basis.
How romantic.
Oh, come on, mate. I've never heard this story.
Well, you didn't know I had this in me.
No wonder you didn't.
Molly has asked the question, and he's really taken me right back to a very emotional moment in my life. I promise you, I used to sit there and get travel sick. I wanted to go. And I know the others sort of shared that feeling. I think every kid that grew up in the early 60s knows exactly what I mean.
And then we got seasick.
And we got seasick. So I set my mind on getting us a trip overseas, because we'd played a couple of gigs on board the Sitmail Line boats when they were in port. And we had a very good relationship with them because of our agency affiliation with the Clemenger Group. We were their advertising agents. So
It simply turned into a business discussion with the managing director of the company, who also said to me the day I had to sign the contract, "Oh, and you'll play dance music as well, won't you?" So lying through my teeth, I said, "Well, yes, of course. I mean, we were a folk band, we were a dance band." But I told the others, and we went out and we revved up on our rock and roll and our dance music as well, and we did folk stuff as well as the dance music.
So you've got to realise this is me playing piano for barn dancing with the guys. Yeah. Athol on, well, Bruce on drums. Keith got electric guitar and Athol was on electric bass.
Yes, I did.
The same show over and over again, all the way to England.
Signed up by Lou Grade, you get a recording contract. Paint the picture of what it was like to have a recording contract back then.
First of all, we did two albums for the World Record Club.
Right.
For 2% royalty or something.
Of 85% less packaging.
Yes. And but we'd kind of become aware of Tom Springfield because Keith had discussions about buying a guitar and things. And the person who was acting as our manager then got in touch with Tom to write us a song. Mm. And he banded together with Tom to actually fund the recording of the first song, which was just going to be an identity, because we'd done so much television, everybody knew who we were, but you weren't able to hear us on the radio. Mm. So the idea of I'll Never Find Another You was simply to just have something to play on air, and nobody ever foresaw that it could go into the top 10 or anything like that.
I have to say that The Carnival Is Over is one of the classic Seeker songs.
Oh, yeah. Yes. And I was listening to it yesterday again and just really marvelling at the way it was recorded. Mm. It's just great. It's got all the elements there. It's very plush and it's just sort of timeless, really. Mm.
It's a great song emotionally. I mean, if a sad song can make you feel good. But I remember the first time we actually sang it live on stage again, the test for the group in any of those songs. What's the reaction going to be from the audience? And we saw people with tears running down their face the first time they heard the song.
Say goodbye, my own true lover, as we sing below the song, how it feels. dawn is waking, and my tears are falling rain. For the carnival is over, we may never meet again. Like a drum, my heart was beating, and your kiss was sweet as wine. But the joy
when Tom Springfield wrote your first three major hits, right? Paul Simon.
Well, Bruce really.
One of the great songwriters.
Yes, one of the great. Paul was working.
Someday or one day, right? We're better.
Someday or one day, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Top 10 hit. Yeah. Paul was working in the folk clubs in England at that time, unknown. We were introduced through a publisher in London, I think, from memory.
Mm. You said Alan Paramore?
Alan Paramore, anyway. He said wanted to meet us. He'd had a song. He'd obviously seen the three number ones.
Mm-hmm.
And I met with him along with the group, and he came to
Tom's flat.
Tom's flat.
Tom's flat, actually, to meet.
Played Someday One Day.
Someday One Day, time's not so far away, we can share.
You got used to sort of having big hits in England and out here in Australia and having number ones. What was it like to go to number one on the American charts? And where were you when you heard it was number one?
Well,
yeah. Athens just trying to
work out who he was.
Okay.
You see, we've been asked this question before.
I Never Found Another Year, though, really, first getting a number one.
Well,
knew where we were.
I'll Never Find Another Year was just sensational. Yeah. I mean, there's just absolutely nothing like it. It's very hard to describe. But we were in our recording company's offices with our PR people that day. But when Georgia Girl went to number one in America, we were locked away playing a three-month pantomime in Bristol.
Right.
Mother
Humpty
Goose.
Dumpty.
It wasn't Mother Goose.
We had more of a sense of frustration with Georgie Girl, I think, because we were in pantomime and we couldn't go to the Oscars and we couldn't celebrate the success we were having.
Right.
Yeah, it was a weird situation. Yes,
we were freezing in Bristol when they were having a great time over at the Oscars.
Hey there, Georgie Girl, swinging down the street so fancy-free. Nobody you meet could ever see the loneliness.
Yeah.
I think the future for us is right now. Every day for us is the future, because we've just had a marvellous experience putting this beautiful album together with great songs, and the album wouldn't have happened if we hadn't found the songs. So we've found yet another wonderful benchmark in our lives. So I think every day we're together, part of the future, and whatever happens next, well, it's a real bonus.
Yes, I mean, this album, yeah, because it's been, people have waited literally 30 years for our next studio album. This is the Future Road album. And we really believed in doing it that we were going to help uplift people in the 90s, hopefully with some, you know, some lovely songs which kind of reflected all the spirit of what we were doing in the 60s. So that's it, really, we really believe we've, you know, put everything into it.
Yeah, it's a way of showing the enthusiasm that we have within the four of us anyway, I feel. And, of course, when the concert series starts, then that'll be translated from the CD into the real life stuff, which is what we enjoy doing so tremendously as well.
If I had the power of the people and I ruled the world, after all that I've seen and the places I've been, nothing would be better than to make a change here or there. Easy to say, but there may be a way. Stand all the people in one line, paint them all in green in the sunshine. Take some chances, come on, let's find the answers. We may stumble, never crumble. Face tomorrow, everyone, all together. Talking about the power of the people, not a perfect world. There's a dream we can choose, one we never will lose. Take a look at all the hopes of every little boy and girl. We can see through the haze, weapons melting away. Turn them all into a fun ship, floating down the river of friendship. Sail forever, you and I together. We may stumble, never crumble. Face tomorrow, everyone, all together. Sunshine. Take some chances, come on, let's find the answers. We may stumble, never crumble, face tomorrow, everyone, all together.
When you look at this album has already gone platinum, I don't think the word existed back then. I think, I mean, gold was certainly, you know, a gold single or a gold album.
That's right.
Was almost the ultimate to reach.
Yes.
This album already gone platinum says something.
Yes, that's right. And I mean, the lovely thing is that we've got new generations of fans coming along. This is what's so incredible. And presumably after we die, there's the songs are going to still live on beyond us. So this is what
I don't plan on doing.
Yes, nice thought. Yes,
on stage.
I prefer them to live on now, if you don't mind.
Carnival was over.
Say goodbye, my old lover.
But Australia just won't let go of the Seekers.
We'll build a world of our own.
Judith Durham and the Seekers are back by popular demand.
You've gotta love someone.
Performing all their classic hits and songs from their new album.
It's calling me home.
The Seekers' 30th anniversary tour. Limited shows only. Book now.
Do you think we're in place of fair fences, dry creeks, clear streams and green hedges as seen? Where the girls have lily and rose in their cheeks, and the grass in midsummer is green? Do you think now and then, now or then in the world, of the city while London is new? Of the hut in the bush and the freckled-faced girl who is eating her heart out for you? Grey eyes that grow sadder than sunset or rain, fond heart that is evermore true, firm faith that grows firmer for watching in vain. She'll wait by the slip rails for you.
Have you always liked the Henry Lawson? Have you studied
Henry actually
Lawson?
Did that basic arrangement and melody of that song in 1974, so I was very much into that from a long time ago. And I liked them because those writers, like Lawson and Banjo Paterson, actually wrote in a style that started to take on the personality of the land they lived in. That's what I liked about it. They also were very good songwriters because those poems were very rhythmic and very musical. So it was a natural thing to draw from that material.
We would like to have had written for us, like Buddy Holly's written by Paul Anker. I guess it doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah.
On the album, which
do you
is
love
beautiful.
Buddy Holly?
I do indeed. Yeah. Well, you know, I mean,
it's
I really
great.
In every
great
sense,
version.
Yeah.
Wasted.
covers, or is if the original version is so good and definitive, you run the risk of coming in with the second best effort. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? So it's really got to be perfect to do something like that.
Well, you have to get very worried then, Bruce, if suddenly you find the Seekers are being sampled. I mean, with say like Puff Daddy or someone like that.
Well, it's happened. I mean, it has happened recently.
Georgia Girl was sampled, and in fact, there's the rap version of Myra.
Dr. Barney.
Yeah, rap version of Myra.
Yeah, the Planet Perfecto, I think it was, isn't it? The group that sampled Georgie Girl.
Yeah.
We're in there.
We're in there.
Part of the 90s in that sense, which is great. Yeah.
But we were so lucky, though, because of Tom Springfield, it meant we didn't have to cover. You know, we were able to be unique.
What? Calling Me Home.
Yeah.
What inspired you to do that?
Because we wanted to have all the elements of the Seekers in a song, and I was writing with Jeff Vincent at the time, and it just seemed to be the right sort of mood to be in to do the Seekers. But both Jeff and I really felt that song wrote itself. It just seemed to be inspired. Similarly, I think Keith had that feeling about one he was doing for this album.
Yeah.
There's a sign up in the sky, and I know the reason why. It's because I'm not alone anymore. Gentle breezes at my back as I'm heading down the track, and I know I'm not alone anymore. 'Cause I'm thankful for the day I found you. Feels so good to be around you. Open
For the first time in 30 years, a new album from Judith Durham and the Seekers, Future Road. Featuring the new single, Calling Me Home. Judith Durham, Bruce Woodley, Keith Potker and Athol Guy together again.
Wait by the slip rails for you.
The unique sound of Judith Durham and the Seekers.
When we
be touched by the magic again with the brilliant new album Future Road.
Future Road.
Out now.
We're sitting here, all very calm. The tour.
Ah. Well, that's going to be very exciting because, I mean, essentially, this band is still alive in your lounge room, in the concert hall band, or wherever you'd like us to play. And to be able to go out again in February and March, right around Australia, and play to that fantastic support that we've always had, and that's been breeding more generations of fans for us. I mean, that's our real buzz, to go out and play more concerts. That's really what all this has been about. It's a great
opportunity. Would you ever think of maybe coming back here at the end of this tour and performing here at the Maya Music Bowl?
That'd be great.
It would be wonderful.
Actually, the thing about that, though, is that Melbourne has embraced us so warmly that we're actually looking like putting in a sixth concert hall performance. So, you know, we may be starting to reach all the people.
Sorry, Keith, I was just going to say that we were talking about special days before and how special this place is. I think, if we could create the right spirit for the day, quite apart from what we're doing in our concerts around the country, it would be a wonderful moment. It'd be a really nice sort of final seal on this stage of the Future Road, if you like.
Yeah, 30 years on.
I was thinking, I mean, like when we were talking about the Maya Music Bowl and we were talking about like the Hector Crawford Music for the People days. And in today's technology, I mean, there are so many records out now. As we said, you know, the melodies are back, the arrangements are back, string arrangements. Mm-hmm. And what a great pity, because a younger generation hear it is really on record. They never really have the chance to see a full orchestra playing as they did here, you know?
Absolutely.
Which would be great if they could come back one day, you know?
Exactly.
A youth.
I agree with that. Yeah. I think it's very important, yeah.
Well, if we could ever do anything to support that, we're on call.
And this is one of the reasons it's so great that EMI and John Kovac have decided to get a project like this going, because how else will people be exposed to this form of music?
Yeah.
We only learned our style from hearing other groups doing it. And, you know, and really you have to have something to, you know, to know whether you're going to like it or not, you've got to hear it first.
Well, I tell you what, there are many groups today, I mean, and I was saying this to Elton when I was interviewing Elton, that there's a great pity that, you know, of bands, the newer bands, only seem to have a longevity, be it sort of, you know, from Nirvana, even Pearl Jam, who've got their problems, Oasis seem to have problems, that they don't last that long, right?
Mm. Yes.
For Future Road, I guess you must be so happy that today we're talking, today you have a platinum album, and it must have been very fulfilling being part of the Seekers.
We are very fulfilled, but we can't emphasise enough, you have to have the support not only of the record company, management and the media, you know, and people like yourself. Without that, it's a complete team. It's like with any of the other groups in the rock industry, you've got to have everybody pulling together and wanting to make it happen. We're very proud. Of course we are. We've always been proud that we can stick together and do this again so late. But it takes everybody, you know, and it's really fantastic, you know, that we're thrilled to bits what's happened.
Well, listen, best of luck. I don't have to wish you luck for the album. Best of luck for the tour. And I think for the four of you, I think one song sums it up, that there is a Future Road. And I guess the song that sums it up is Forever Isn't Long Enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you a lot, Molly. It's great.
I hear people say forever and a day. And now that I've found you, I know what it means, more than eternity. But even then you see, forever isn't long enough for me. I want you in my arms to kiss, to feel our hearts entwined. I want our love to last like this.
so strong, there's only one thing wrong. Forever isn't long enough for me. With every step we take and promises we make, the road paved with dreams, and I know they'll come true. If only there could be a little more, you see. Forever isn't long enough for me. I want you in my arms to kiss, to feel the hearts entwined. Strong.